Well, here am I, crouched next to my Brompton. I've got a bit of a ride I want to do on this bike, because I got one of my circular rides that I do. It's 27.42 kilometres, and I did it last on my old touring bike, which is a 40-year-old bike, but it's a really nice bike to ride. It rolls really nicely. And it's quite a quick bike for what it is. I've done the 27.42 kilometres in 1 hour and 9 minutes. Now I want to see. I'm going to do exactly the same route. We've got similar conditions. There's very low wind. There was very low wind when I did that ride, so there's low wind today. I want to know what the Brompton's capable of, if I can return a similar speed. I don't think I will, simply for two reasons. One is I haven't got such a tall gear in on this bike as I got on the other bike, and the second thing is I think with these tiny wheels they are not as efficient. But this would be definitive proof to myself when I go out and ride this exact same route. But the thing I'm going to do, I've got this lovely pump called a Lazine. I'm going to pump the tyres up really, really hard, because they say for the Bromptons, for them to run with low rolling resistance, you've got to have really high pressure in the tyres, about 100 psi. So I'm going to pump these right up hard, and then I'm going to get out on this ride and see how it compares with the other bike. Incidentally, for those of you that followed my King Arthur's Way, the mountain bike is still under reconstruction. I've got a new bottom bracket fitted to it now. I've got to get new chain rings, a new crank set. I've got to get new rear derailleur and fit new cables. And then that bike would be good again. But I had a bit of a mishap on my old touring bike. I went out for a ride on that a few days back, and I fitted a brand new free wheel to it. And as I was cycling along, this new free wheel became loose. I lost all the bearings, so the free wheels are cheap anyway, so I've ordered another free wheel. So currently my old Revel Romani touring bike is off the road again.
It's bad news. I'm not having a lot of luck with bike mechanicals at the moment. For some reason the free wheel's had it on this one.
Really, really high quality pump is the design. It's got a built-in pressure gauge there. So let's whack some air in. Let's put a bit more air in. They're not the easiest of tyres, it has to be said, to blow up. And I think this is a high volume pump, but it will get up to 160 psi. They reckon, but I'm putting 100 in. Oh, I'm nearly on 100.
25 past 10 in the morning, just gone, and I've started my journey. I always pedal a bit gentle to start off with, get the old legs warmed up. If you're wondering, I've got my Garmin device down there. That'll track the journey and upload it to Strava when I finish. Coming to the King's Down Inn. When I come to a stop, the Garmin device will automatically stop as well. So it should go on a pause. Yeah, pause. About 19 mile an hour. I don't know if I can spin the pedals that much quicker, to be honest with you. Gearing is a bit low, a bit short compared to what I got on the other bike. One thing I got to say is, on my previous ride on my older bike, when I did this same journey, I wasn't filming, so the filming definitely is slowing me down a little bit, I say. The other thing I say, being only a 3-speed, the gears are a bit of a compromise. Not a bad compromise, but you can't quite get that optimal ratio. But it's not so bad. Slight downhill now. Almost 20 mile an hour. 20 mile an hour. Spinning out. Just entering the village of Seven Hampton. Got my first climb in a minute. Horses in the way as well. This is a Seven Hampton climb. Go down in the first gear. I'm climbing at 8.6 miles an hour, which was exactly the same speed, more or less, that I was climbing up on my full-size bike. I'm going a bit slower now. I'd say, yeah, I'm on a slower up here, I think. Over the bridge at West Mill. And up the hill the other side. That's it, 6.27 miles. That will convert to kilometres when I upload it to Strava. But we're in to the village of Watchfield now. So I do a left here. A number of years ago, about 30 years ago, they built an extension, or a bypass rather, to the A420, one of the main roads which goes to Oxford. And when they put the bypass in, they went smack bang wallop through the middle of an Anglo-Saxon burial ground. And I'll show you where that was, because we cycle more or less through the centre of it as well, but avoiding the A420. So this footpath, or this byway I'm riding on here, runs parallel to the A420, which is over there, and it's right in the middle of the Anglo-Saxon burial ground. Tragic. Anyway, the dead no longer rest in peace along that piece of road. Here we are, coming into Shrovenham. 10.4 miles now, and 43 minutes. 43 minutes into the ride, and I'd say the saddle just beginning to get a little bit uncomfortable. But still good for a bit more yet. This is Shrovenham Memorial Hall. A sign there, hidden by the grass, says welcome to Shrovenham. But we're just leaving it. I've got two hill climbs to go, and about 6 miles. Then we're back home. Well, three if you count this little hill. Bridge over the horrible A420. I'm cycling into a breeze, stiffish headwind. The upright position of the Brompton means I catch all the wind, so that's going to slow me down a little bit. You can get different configurations. If I could, I think I'd go to the flat bars, but to do that you've got to also change the stem, the steering stem. So it's not easy.
I'm on the penultimate hill now. Bit of a stiff climb this. Going up at about 5.3 miles per hour in first gear. Yeah.
Doable. I remember I was a bit quicker on my other bike, but I'm doing it on the Brompton.
This ride doesn't feel as fast as the other bike, but we'll know when we get home exactly how fast it is.
I'm back in the village of Sevenhampton now, just got the last sort of last hill. There are little inclines after this, but there's not nothing to write home about. But this is the last hill of any note before I get back home. Just round this bend, there's the hill that goes up. It's not too bad, but you do feel it. That second gear, I'll try and make it to the bend and then I'll go in at first. Now in first gear. For some reason, it's jumped back into top gear. I don't know why it's done that. I'm stand on the pedals. The rear hub wasn't having none of it. It went into first gear and it jumped out. Went into, I think, second. Needs adjusting. Anyway, I'm at the top. Well, I just stopped this back there. The GPS went onto a pause and I adjusted the rear geared hub. The little locking ring had come loose. I think probably my mistake. Anyway, I've got all my three gears back again now. Yeah, just looking at the GPS. I was home at this point. I still got a bit to run. But I have stopped a couple of times. Filming that's probably slowed me down a little bit. The upright sitting position slowed me down a little bit. So there are a few handicaps, should we say. Back at the Kingsdown pub, waiting for the lights to change. That's it, back home. Let's upload the thing to Strava, see what it says.
Right, I've got some figures. So I rode the same route twice now. First of all on my old Level Romany, which is a touring bike with 732C wheels, but I got 28C tyres on it, pumped up nice and hard, and I rode, I'll give you it in metric to start off with. The route was 27.42 miles long. On the full size bike, it took me exactly 1 hour and 9 minutes for an average speed of 23.83 kilometres. On the Brompton, the exact same route took me 1 hour 13 minutes and 58 seconds for an average speed of 22.23 kilometres an hour. Now, conditions were pretty much the same. A slight breeze heading back home into the westerly direction, which is about normal for this area. And I think it was the same when I rode the other night on the full-size bike as well. So those figures in miles per hour are a total distance of 17.04 miles ridden. For the full size bike it was 14.8 miles per hour at average speed. For the Brompton it was exactly 1 mile per hour less at 13.8 miles per hour average speed. So that's not a great deal. Not sure what that is in percentage terms. I'll work it out and put it up on the screen. But when you consider that you're at a very upright seating position, so you've got the full, you're not aerodynamic, you've got the full force of the airflow acting on your body, so you've got to overcome that. And the tiny wheels, they do add a little bit to the rolling resistance. When you're over going over solid, hard surfaces, it's fine, but anything soft, you lose a lot of energy. So I think, yeah, we all knew there's going to be a little bit of a loss in the efficiency of the Brompton when compared to a full-size bike. But to me, 1 mile per hour, I mean, if I'm going to be cycling for 6 to 8 hours, then I'm going to be 6 or 8 miles short at the end of my day's journey. So instead of, say, covering 60 or 70 mile, say, instead of covering, say, 70 mile, I'll only cover 62 mile. So it's up to the individual whether that's good or not. But for me, the Brompton's good points, its strength, so the fact that it's foldable, transportable, and it can allow certain adventures and things to happen that a full-size bike can't. And you also haven't got the worry when you go shopping, you can fold it up, take it into the shop with you. You haven't got the worry that you've left your pride and joy outside, locked up somewhere for some thieves to nick. And they do nick things, especially in the towns. So I hope that's been of interest to somebody. Oh, people do ask me about this Brompton and the setup. This is the Brompton A line. It came with the 44 tooth front sprocket. My mate Dave gave me a 15 tooth rear sprocket. You can buy them online. They're about £3.99, and you can that gears the bike down and gives you better ratios for climbing the hills. But you do spin out at around about 20 to 22 miles an hour in top gear, so you're not going to go as fast in top gear as you could on a full size bike with lower gearing, or taller gearing rather. So that's it overall. I'm satisfied with the Brompton. The saddle is not very good. I get away with about an hour, my three quarters of an hour starting to feel uncomfortable, and then I started to feel comfortable again, but I know after that it's downhill. And I think it's because of the upright position, you're putting a lot more weight through your backside into the saddle. And also I come to understand that a soft saddle isn't necessarily the most comfortable over a longer time. If you're riding only a short distance, soft saddles are very comfortable, but when you start sitting in the saddle for several hours, that soft saddle, it's got a lot more surface area in contact with your backside, and it cuts off blood flow and causes all sorts of issues. And I've got several different saddles on my bikes. I've got a charged spoon saddle, I've got this saddle, and I got a Brooks B17. And I can say hand on heart, the Brooks B17 is the most comfortable out of all three of them. But they're not cheap. So that's it. I hope that's been of interest to somebody. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.